Morning all, and we're going to start off a news of the day video with a retraction that was brought out by the Ottawa Sun today. And you know what? At a time where the media doesn't normally do this, kudos to them for that. And apologies to Eugene Melnyk while we're at it. So they've apologized to Eugene Melnyk regarding the article that they put out last week, and they've corrected some flaws. Now, what's going to happen to the reporter who reported all of that? You just don't know. And this is where you have to ask, okay, so did they just talk to the charity and not double check, or how does this work? And one thing that happens with the media now is it's about getting the story first. And that's the big thing, getting the story first. And I know even as a YouTuber, I'll see like something gets reported and I go, well, there's not really a lot of facts. And then I'll see a bunch of stuff coming up and I'm like, okay, well, I wasn't the first to report it if that ends up being true. That happens with trades. It happens with free agency. It happens with everything. And I like to, you know, make sure that there's some relative certainty to what I'm reporting. So the rent, which they reported as being hundreds of thousands of dollars over the years, it was $78,750 in 2019. Then the Senators have said this is below market value. Now, I'm not sure what market value would be for having that space in that building. I have no idea. And they're saying they were required by law to charge rent in order to make sure that the charity was at an arm's length from the team. So, you know, to make sure it is a different entity and they can prove, hey, it's a different entity. Look, we're charging them rent. And the Oregon Project's main goal was to spend money it raised on activities aimed at promoting Oregon awareness and registration. So that's why they didn't really spend money outside the organization. I'm not going to say one way or the other what happened with any of that or anything like that. I just, you know, it's an interesting story. I don't think we've heard the end of it. I don't. I think that the charity issue for the Senators, one thing they did not dispute was whether or not Melnyk was trying to say, hey, here's where I want the money to go. And the charity went, no, we do youth sports. So it is the story that keeps going. And again, we'll see if we hear again from the Senators charity. Are they going to have to change their name because they're not associated with the Senators anymore? Will that hurt their fundraising? I would think that it would, not having that NHL tie-in anymore. So there we go. Now, it's expected today, and I'm not sure when today, and I'm not just going to wait to do this video until it's officially announced, but it's expected that the Canadian government's going to announce that there's going to be rules for sports in Canada where sporting athletes coming in won't have to do the 14-day shelter in place as anybody else entering the country does. But before people get all like, see, this is one set of rules for athletes, they're not allowed to go anywhere public either. So they can't go to the store. There's a lot of places they can't go. It's basically you're at home or you're at the facility, and the facility needs to be bubbled off so that you're not associating yourself with any of the general public. So that's the plan. And of course, this might be part of the reason why a naming hub cities is still a process that hasn't been, you know, fully fleshed out yet. We don't know where they're going to go. We know that Vegas is likely. And it's possible we hear today from the NHL once this has been announced, okay, this is what we're going to do. Now, according to, and this is coming from Elliot Friedman of Sportsnet, the plan is to have triple headers, and he doesn't think it's going to be anything other than in the main building. So you may just have T-Mobile in Vegas, three games a day. And so just think about this with playoff rules. And they even asked Friedman about this on Sportsnet. Well, what happens if a game goes into triple overtime? Well, then it goes into triple overtime. And in the playoffs, we know if there's a setup that you can't have triple, quadruple overtimes. We're going to have triple, quadruple overtimes. And he expects the first game of the day to start at 10 o'clock Eastern. That's 7 o'clock in the morning my time. Going to be some long days because that means you could go from 7 till 10 for the first game. And then you could go, you've got to think they'll have some kind of cleanup process in between games 1 and 2. So probably, 12 to 3, and then maybe one from 5 till 8 my time. But again, all the overtimes could mean that all goes out the window. And of course, with the NHL plan, that'd be six games a day. So we're going to see players come in to play, and they're going to be out in three games. That's going to happen. There's going to be players that are out in four games. And it's going to get easier, but those first, that play-in round and then the first round of the playoffs, it's going to be kind of long-winded. Now, I had planned before the playoffs this year anyways, when I was trying to figure out how to do previews and reviews, I thought, you know what? I'm going to split them up. So I'm going to do previews and reviews for each individual series. And now it looks like doing that where I review each game in its own video, that's probably the best plan anyways, because they're not going to be played at the same time. Although, there could be three in one location, three in the other location. There's going to be overlap. I'll do my best to review them as well as I can and take as many notes as I can. Because this is going to be fascinating, but I'm one person. So, I'll do my best, and it's going to be probably some long days for me. Which is fine. Because, honestly, being able to watch hockey and have long days of watching hockey, I am perfectly fine with that. That doesn't bother me in the slightest. That sounds great. But, just as a reminder, it's still out there, Boston Bruin has tested positive, asymptomatic, which is to be expected with, if it's a younger player, that makes total sense, and some of the older players may very well be asymptomatic as well. They're athletes, and, you know, they're in very good shape, and they may very well not show symptoms. So, he'll be isolated, and he's tested negative twice since he tested positive, so my understanding is he tested positive. What was the date that he tested positive? So he doesn't have it now, but he did. And that brings up to so far, we know of 10 that have had it. So that's 10 overall. And odds are it's likely higher than that. But again, this is where things are going to get interesting. Because now that you're bringing all the players in and you're testing them all before you get into these small groups, this is where if you're going to make the bubble work in the hub cities, you have to make sure the testing is daily and it is rigorous and it's everybody, or else the whole thing could fall apart. Now, New Jersey, speaking of things that fell apart this year, horrible segue, and yet here we are. Peter Laviolette could very well be the next coach. So remember a couple days ago when I said, there's no rush? Apparently Laviolette might be the reason there's no rush. He may very well be the next coach of the New Jersey Devils, and he'd be a good pick. Laviolette is a pretty good coach. I was surprised when he got fired this year when he did, but, you know, coaches like that normally don't stay out of work for very long, and it looks like Laviolette may be one of those guys who doesn't stay out of work for very long. So, all the best to him if he ends up going to New Jersey, and if New Jersey hires him, that's a good move. I do think the New Jersey Devils have a very good chance of bouncing back, and if Laviolette's their coach, I think that helps all the more. So, if you're a Devils fan that's been waiting for some good news, I would qualify that as being good news. Absolutely. Now, Dmitry Samarukov, prospect for the Edmonton Oilers, who played at Bakersfield this year and had 10 points in 47 games, he's signing a one-year deal for CSKA in the KHL. And he's a third-round pick from 2017, and they view him as maybe being a potential power play quarterback. He is below Bouchard and Broberg on their prospects list. So Broberg and Bouchard are the big future on that blue line. And he's seen as being more of the secondary guy, but a potential power play quarterback. Not liking the idea of waiting 9 months to play hockey. So, signing in the KHL, one-year deal, meaning he can go back after that. And Ken Holland's come out and said, that's a good idea, that's a good choice. And I think we'll see a lot of those in-between prospects, guys who may not want to wait until January to play hockey if they're going to play in January, signing overseas. And, of course, if the AHL were suspended this coming season, if we end up in a situation where they say, we just can't make any money in the AHL, we're going to suspend operations for a year, where a lot of players are going to go over to Europe, a lot of them, which is going to hurt European players in those leagues. I remember thinking that in 2004-05 as well, when the NHL was shut down, everything was shut down. And I remember thinking, gee, you know, there's probably a lot of European players that aren't getting ice time right now because all these North Americans have come over and taken it from them while they're sitting out and not playing in North America. It felt like kind of a dick move at the time, to be honest. I mean, it leads to some great hockey, right, if you're a European fan. But for those players to see all these guys just come over and just take everything and then they go back the next year. Anyways, we'll see what happens and how many prospects sign overseas contracts over the next month or two. Now, here's the interesting thing, too, about the hub cities. So, circling back on the hub cities. Toronto is apparently emerging as an East Coast favorite. Now, this is from Toronto Media, so you may want to take it with a grain of salt. But there's something to this. Toronto hosted the World Cup. Toronto has the necessary ability to wall these players off and have that bubble. And I have to say, while some in Edmonton wouldn't like it, there's some in Vancouver that wouldn't like it because of all the work that's been done in both. Definitely, Alberta's been very outspoken about wanting Edmonton to be a hub city. But Toronto would make some sense. And again, going back with Elliot Friedman, he believes that the NHL wants to have one in the States and one in Canada. Now with the Canadian government being willing to be flexible on the 14-day quarantine and making it so you don't have shelter at home, you can just, you know, be at work and at home. This would apparently be the case with essential workers as well. You're either at work or you're at home. And again, we'll see what they announce. That announcement hasn't come yet. May come later. I may not be home at the time it's announced. I can almost guarantee I won't be home at the time that it's announced. There's a possibility I'm going out today. Not a very good possibility, but there's a possibility. And if that's the case, that's when they'll announce it, because that's how that works. Part of the reason I think why the NHL hasn't had anything done is because I've been home for the last 3 months. So they're like, we'll wait till he goes out. He's not going out? Fine, we don't have to announce anything. So I apologize for delaying the process by being home. But yeah, the Toronto being a favorite, that would make some sense. Again, I understand local numbers may be alarming to some. Brian Burke made the point where he doesn't think that the infection rates in any location matter. If the players are properly isolated and if the bubble is properly maintained, he doesn't think that local numbers should matter at all. As long as there's some agreement between government, health officials, and the NHL on where to play and how to do this, and they stay in constant communication, he doesn't think it's a big deal. So we'll see. I think it is, but he did make a good point about, hey, as long as the bubble's solid, as long as they have a plan, and then with each round, you have less players to worry about. So it gets kind of easier. So the other thing too, and Elliot Friedman was asked about this, and he said he expects the flat cap to be a thing for the next 2 years, might be 3 years, but the expectation is a flat cap. And of course, next year they're looking at the US TV deal, and they would be eyeing the idea of ESPN coming in and having the NHL on its network, which would then lead to probably ESPN having just a lot more hockey programming on there in general. A lot of the specials and documentaries that we all like so much. So we'll see what happens. I'm not sure how much that TV deal is necessarily going to get next year. Because again, with what we're going through now and what it's done to the economy, that may drop the price. They may have to get creative with that contract and have some kind of a fluctuation in there where it can adjust up if things get better economically, or it could adjust down if things get worse. So the risk would then be on the NHL that it might be less, but the reward would be there as well that it could end up being more. Some advertising deals are going to have to get really creative, but we'll see what they do. And when they announce it, I'll be here. Or when they announce it, I won't be home, and I'll do a video on it as soon as they announce it. That's normally what happens, right? There you go. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below as always. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe if you're browsing your way through. You just happened upon this video. Thank you guys so much for watching, for all your support. I will talk to you again soon.